sing this song of gladness. Give my praise to the fountain of delights. For in my helplessness, you heard my cry. And waves of mercy poured down on my life. I will trust in the cross of my Redeemer. I will sing of the blood that never fails, of sins forgiven, of conscience cleansed, of death defeated and life without end. You live for sin.
Savior, Good morning, and a warm welcome to Christ Church for our service of morning worship. Before we start, there are a few notices. Please pray for Margaret and Bill Howard from Emmanuel, who start their visit to Kenya on Tuesday. Please pray that the visit will be rewarding for all involved. Our shoebox campaign has started. We need items to go in the shoeboxes, please, which can be brought to the church. And we do have some shoebox available at £1 each. Other shoeboxes are welcome, and we hope to have a good collection for this year. There's a quiz night for the Building Fund on Saturday the 29th of October. Please contact Mandy Campbell or the church office for information on this. On the 23rd of October, we have a visit to Christchurch by one of our mission partners, Pappy Daniel. Please come and hear him speak. Unfortunately, he will not be able to record his sermon. There will be a barbecue, bring and share lunch after the service, and you are most welcome to join us for that. Now let us just take a moment or two to bring ourselves before God, to remember everything that he has done for us, and to pray for the world and those around us. So grace, mercy and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you, and also with you. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Lord, direct our thoughts. Teach us to pray. Lift up our hearts to worship you in spirit and in truth, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We come now to our time of confession. We think over the last week or so and remember those things that we have done that would not have been pleasing to God. Those things we should have done, the things we have said, even the things we have thought. It's a chance now to come before God and to seek his forgiveness and to seek his blessing as we go into the weeks ahead. Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have failed you, as did your first disciples. We ask for your mercy and your help. Most merciful God, we confess to you before the whole company of heaven and one another that we have sinned in thought, word and deed, and in what we have failed to do. Forgive us our sins, heal us by your Spirit, and raise us to new life in Christ. Amen. May the God of love bring us back to himself, forgive us our sins, and assure us of his eternal love in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now Jennifer brings us our Bible readings, after which Pete will be speaking to us.
The Old Testament reading is taken from the second book of Kings, chapter 5, beginning at verse 1. Now Naaman was commander of the army of the king of Aram. He was a great man in the sight of his master and highly regarded, because through him the Lord had given victory to Aram. He was a valiant soldier, but he had leprosy. Now bands from Aram had gone out and taken captive a young girl from Israel, and she served Naaman's wife. She said to her mistress, "If only my master would see the prophet who is in Samaria, he would cure him of his leprosy." As soon as the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his robes and said, "Am I God? Can I kill and bring back to life? Why does this fellow send someone to me to be cured of his leprosy? See how he is trying to pick a quarrel with me." When Elijah, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his robes, he sent him this message: "Why have you torn your robes? Make the man come to me, and he will know that there is a prophet in Israel. So Naaman went with his horses and chariots and stopped at the door of Elisha's house. Elisha sent a messenger to say to him, Go, wash yourself 7 times in the Jordan, and your flesh will be restored, and you will be cleansed. But Naaman went away angry and said, I thought that he would surely come down out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God, wave his hand over the spot and cure me of my leprosy. Are not Abana and Pharpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than any of the rivers of Israel? Couldn't I wash in them and be cleansed? So he turned and went off in a rage. Naaman's servants went to him and said, Father, if the prophet had told you to do some great thing, would you not have done it? How much more then when he tells you, wash and be cleansed? So he went down and dipped himself in the Jordan 7 times as the man of God had told him, and his flesh was restored and became clean like that of a young boy. Then Naaman and all his attendants went back to the man of God. He stood before him and said, Now I know that there is no God in all the world except in Israel. The second reading is taken from the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 17, beginning at verse 11. Now on his way to Jerusalem, Jesus travelled along the border between Samaria and Galilee. As he was going into a village, 10 men who had leprosy met him. They stood at a distance and called out to him in a loud voice, Jesus, Master, have pity on us. When he saw them, he said, Go, show yourselves to the priests. And as they went, they were cleansed. One of them, when he saw that he was healed, came back, praising God in a loud voice. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him, and he was a Samaritan. Jesus asked, Were not all 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner? Then he said to him, Rise and go. Your faith has made you well. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Let's pray. Father, may these spoken words be true to the written word and lead us to the living word, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Today, we're going to be looking at one man's experience of God through the story of Naaman. The backdrop to the story we heard part of in this morning's reading is an ongoing border skirmishes between Aram and Israel. There was supposed to be a treaty. They're not quite at war yet, but Ben-Hadid II, king of Aram, and Jehoram, king of Israel, are almost there. We can read how that situation escalated in the next chapters of 2 Kings. For now though, let's concentrate on the events in our reading today. In one of these skirmishes, a young girl has been taken captive, kidnapped. My commentary calls her a maiden. So she was too young to be a wife of someone, but she has been forced into slavery. She is serving Naaman's wife. We cannot tell what the atmosphere was like in that household, whether she was well treated or whether she was poorly treated. But we do know that she had faith in the Lord, and that she was old enough to know and understand about the prophet Elisha. She was also, of course, aware of Naaman's condition. Leprosy is now known as Hansen's disease. It's a bacteriological infection that affects the nerves and the skin. Today, it is easily treated with antibiotics. But according to the American Center for Disease Control, those antibiotics have to be taken for a year to make sure that the disease is eradicated. Hansen's disease now is not particularly contagious, but in biblical times, leprosy was thought to be very infectious. Without our diagnostic abilities, it was a generic description for all sorts of skin diseases. It takes courage for a young girl to speak up, especially when she's a captive in a foreign land. Why should she care anyway? Why should she do something to aid her enemy? Surely she should keep quiet and hope that Naaman gets worse so that he can no longer command the army of her enemies. That would be the best thing to do. That would be the correct military strategy. But we know that Jesus said, love your enemies. And that idea exists in the Old Testament too. In Proverbs 25, 21 and 22 it says, if your enemy is hungry, give him food to eat, and if he is thirsty, give him water to drink. For you will heap burning coals on his head, and the Lord will reward you. So that is what she does. And that is exactly what she should do in her situation. She knows, because she has faith in the Lord, that the prophet can and will cure Naaman. If he is not cured, things could get even worse for her. Then, our reading inexplicably skips over three verses, where Naaman gets a letter from Ben-Hadid II and takes with him 10 talents of silver, 6,000 shekels of gold, and 10 sets of clothing. Those are to pay the prophet for his healing. The king also gives him a letter for the king of Israel. He will need this, because if he is found in Israel without it, the Israelites might assume that some sort of invasion has begun, and then war would break out. The king's letter reads like this. With this letter, I am sending my servant Naaman to you, so that you may cure him of his leprosy. It has to be one of the most incompetent letters I've ever seen. And I'm being generous. If this is the calibre of leadership in the area, then I'm really not surprised that they were in a state of almost constant war. It should be no surprise to any of us the way Jehoram reacted. Of course the king can't cure leprosy. Fortunately, Elijah is there to pick up the pieces. And I know how he feels, having had to pick up the pieces for various pieces of poor communication between senior leaders in my career, I know exactly what he's experiencing. Thankfully, though, I was never asked to cure leprosy. Elisha tells the king, have the man come to me, and he will know that there is a prophet in Israel. Elisha's concern is not really to heal Naaman, but to give glory to God, to make God's name known beyond the borders of Israel. That is the Israelites' purpose. That's what they were chosen to do. Not to establish and secure the borders of the promised land, but to give glory to God among the nations. Elisha knows his calling, and everything that follows is intended to fulfill it. When Naaman arrives at Elisha's place with the horses and the chariots, he is expecting the full works. He's an important man, and he knows it. The prophet, or wizard, which is probably closer to Naaman's view of Elisha, should be present, and should put on some sort of grand show, lots of arm waving and a few strategic explosions, perhaps something like that, something that is nice and notable and memorable, a really good show. Instead, he gets a messenger with a really short, almost curt message. Go, wash yourself in the Jordan 7 times, and your flesh will be restored, and you will be cleansed. His expectations have not been met, and he is losing face with his whole entourage. He feels humiliated. Maybe he even sees something of the ongoing conflict in this. My river is better than yours. So in his anger, he turns and goes towards home. It's been a wasted journey. You know, I'd love to know how much time passed between verse 12, where he turns and goes, and verse 13, where the servants have a word with him. How far did he get? How long did it take him before he calmed down enough to listen to reason? At some point before he arrives back in Aram, the servants, who are used to being given the brush off, as all servants are, got to him and made the case for giving the Jordan a try. If the prophet had asked you to do something really difficult, you would have done it, wouldn't you? So why not try the simple thing? If the prophet had asked Naaman to complete some great quest, Naaman would have been able to claim that what he did had cured him. He would have treated the whole episode as another successful military campaign, with all the self-glorifying stories that those always generate. If that had happened, Elisha's desire that Naaman should know that there is a prophet in Israel would have failed. So he goes to the Jordan and dipped himself in the required 7 times. When he came out, not only had his skin complaint been cured, but the anti-wrinkle properties had worked as well, and he looked years younger. Now this foreigner, this outsider, this non-believer, this enemy returns to Elisha. With his entire entourage, he is there to give thanks and to give the gifts that he had brought specifically for that purpose. This time, the prophet comes out to meet him and to hear him say, "Now I know that there is no God in all the world except in Israel." And now Naaman offers the gifts. But it is almost certainly not about payment, because that again would detract from the glory that should be given to God for the healing that has been performed. Elisha will not accept the gifts. If we read on a little, we will see that Naaman has indeed been changed by his experiences. He asks for and is given Israelite earth to take back with him to kneel on when he is making offerings to God. When he is chased by Elisha's servant, Gehazi, he gets off his horse. That alone indicates that he has changed. He has recognized the Lord and is now more humble because of it. It's not just the disease and the wrinkles that have gone, but the self-importance as well. Important men do not dismount for servants, however urgently they may be calling out. Naaman has been fully healed. Just as in Luke, it was the foreigner, the outsider, the Samaritan, who properly recognized Jesus and came back to give thanks. So here it is the Aramean, who recognizes the Lord, in front of whom all his local gods pale into insignificance. There is something about coming before God for the first time. Both Naaman and the Samaritan experienced it. It somehow has a greater effect on us than it does when it occurs a second or a tenth time. Maybe you still remember your first encounter. Maybe you still remember some others as well. That's why Elijah's strategy has been so carefully planned and executed. Even though he said, so that he will know that there is a prophet in Israel, to the king, his real intent was to help Naaman meet God. He carefully stepped out of the way and allowed that to happen. He was then insistent on not taking payment to ensure that nothing could be taken away from that experience. Naaman, the commander of the enemy's armies, met God and was changed. Hopefully, we can be like Elisha and strategically help people to have that experience of meeting God for the first time themselves. Amen.
And now we're going to listen to or join in with the song, Yet Not I, But Through Christ in Me, which reminds us that everything we do, strategically or otherwise, we do because we have Christ within us.
What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Dark, but I am not forsaken, for by my side the Savior He will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need His power is displayed. To this I hope, my Shepherd will defend. He will lead. Oh, the night has been won, and I shall overcome, yet not I, but through Christ in me. No fate I dread, sure, the price it has been paid. For Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and He was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hold, my sin has been defeated. Jesus now and ever is my plea. The chains are released, I can sing, I am free, yet not I, but through Christ in me. With every breath, I long to follow Jesus. For He has said that He will bring me home. And day by day, I know He will renew.
Thank you, Pete, for your word to us this morning. We come now to our creed, where we state what we believe. If you would like to and are able to do so, please stand. So let us affirm our faith together. We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. And now we come to our prayers. And for our prayers this morning, I am using the words of the worship song, "Jesus is King and I Will Extol Him," by Wendy Churchill. Jesus is King and I will extol him. Give him the glory and honour his name. He reigns on high, enthroned in the heavens, Word of the Father, exalted for us. Lord, we come before you today in thankfulness for our lives, for our food and shelter, for our families and friends, for all you have given us. Most of all, we thank you for your love for each one of us. And we ask that we may show your love in our love for our neighbours and for all creation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We have a hope that is steadfast and certain, gone through the curtain and touching the throne. We have a priest who is there interceding, pouring his grace on our lives day by day. Lord, we come before you to pray for the areas of the world where there is fear, war, injustice, oppression, natural disaster. Especially we pray for the situation in Ukraine, and we pray for those seeking to show your love, seeking to bring your justice and your peace. We pray for those bereaved and injured in the attacks in Thailand and Mexico. We think of those affected by the floods in Pakistan, by Hurricane Ian in Cuba, Florida and the Carolinas, and the typhoon in Japan. And we pray for those seeking to bring your love, seeking to bring your comfort and support to those affected. We pray for those in our family, in our church, in our community, who need to know your love at this time. We take a moment to name them, either silently or out loud. And we pray that we may be the ones to show love to those in need. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We come to him, our priest and apostle, clothed in his glory and bearing his name, laying our lives with gladness before him. Filled with his spirit, we worship the King. Lord, we pray now for ourselves as your people, your children. You know each one of us. You love each one of us. May we never forget to say thank you. And in a prayer from the Methodist Church, God of all grace, I rise from this place, hoping to seek out and live your plan for my life, seeking to know more of you and be known by you, seeking to make you known in my friendships and relationships and in the world around me. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Holy One, our hearts do adore you. Thrilled with your goodness, we give you our praise. Angels in light, with worship surround you. Jesus, our Saviour, forever the same. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And we come now to the familiar words of the Lord's Prayer. As Jesus taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and for ever. Amen. And the Collect for the 17th Sunday after Trinity. Gracious God, you call us to fullness of life. Deliver us from unbelief and banish our anxieties with the liberating love of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And our final worship song, an old hymn with very true and relevant words, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling.
Jesus, thou art all compassion, pure and
It's been lovely to worship with you this morning. Just a reminder that the office is open from Monday through to Thursday, and the coffee shop is open on Tuesday, Wednesday and Friday. All of those are in the morning. So that also means that the church is open every morning this week if you wish to come in for private prayer or just sit in the silence. A reminder also that when Pappy Daniel comes on the 23rd of October, there will be a lunch for him after the service. If you are able to donate food, or indeed if you wish to sign up to say you are coming, there is a list in the church, or please give the office a ring. All contact details will be on the screen after this service. And now we come to our final prayer. Almighty God, we thank you for the gift of your holy word. May it be a lantern to our feet, a light upon our paths, and a strength to our lives. Take us and use us to love and serve all people in the power of your Holy Spirit and in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So let's go in peace to love and to serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, Amen.